Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Imams al-Bukhari and Muslim reported on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhuma that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا مَثَلُ صَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ كَمَثَلِ صَاحِبِ الْإِبِلِ الْمُعَلَّقَةِ إِنْ عَاهَدَ عَلَيْهَا أَمْسَكَهَا وَإِنْ أَطْلَقَهَا ذَهَبَتْ. The similitude of the companion of the Qur'an, the one who has the Qur'an as his friend, always with it, always reciting it, always reviewing it, always memorizing it, is like that of the owner of a hobbled camel. If he is continuously cautious, he will retain it. But if he neglects it, it runs away. People with regards to the Qur'an are at different levels. Some people only listen to the Qur'an. Some people only recite the Qur'an. Some people partially memorize the Qur'an. And a blessed selected group memorize the entire Qur'an. And the scholars said that people's level and rank are proportional to the amount they memorize with the condition that they act upon it. And Allah Azza wa Jal created mankind and He instilled in us to naturally forget things. And that's why when someone memorizes the Qur'an and does not repeat it, review it frequently, he will forget it. Likewise in anything else, in math, in engineering, in medicine, if the person does not refresh his memory frequently and continuously, the tendency is to forget. And the scholar said perhaps there is a wisdom behind this, behind us forgetting. And they mentioned among the things, one, that if we were to memorize and not to forget, then the hearts would not be distinguished. The one whose heart is attached to the Qur'an will not be distinguished from the one who's careless. How? When we forget, the one who's keen, the one who's careful, the one who has the Qur'an as his companion will continuously and frequently review and recite the Qur'an. Why? He doesn't want to forget it. Whereas the other type is indifferent. He neglects it and stops reciting it or reviewing it until he forgets it. Another issue here is pertaining to the reward. Imagine if we memorize the Qur'an and have no worries about forgetting it, then there will be no motivation for us to frequently recite the Qur'an and therefore lose out on an abundant amount of reward. As in the narration of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, reported by At-Tirmidhi, classified as authentic by Al-Albani, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever recites a letter from the book of Allah will get a reward, and that reward will be multiplied tenfold. And then he said, I don't mean to say that Alif Lam Mim altogether is a letter, but rather Alif is a letter, Lam is a letter, and Mim is a letter. And for information, there are about 325,000 letters in the Qur'an. You see the amount of reward one would be losing out on if he does not or she does not recite the Qur'an continuously? There is a shepherd from Sudan who memorizes the Qur'an. A man asked him, every how often do you finish the Qur'an? He said, every 2 days. He said, you mean to tell me that you review 15 juz' of the Qur'an, half of the Qur'an daily? He said, yes. But sometimes I get lazy and I finish it every 3 days. That's 1/3 of the Qur'an per day. That's one who is keen on maintaining and retaining his memorization of the Qur'an. Ibn Hajar, rahmatullahi alayhi, said, the reason the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used the camel in particular for the similitude here is that the camel is known to be the one animal that has the most tendency to run away. Now once it runs away, it is the most difficult animal to retain and bring back. And he said, this is why. The Qur'an, once it leaves you, it takes a whole lot of effort to retain it again. So, just as a camel owner is keen on tying its knees, this is how they prevent the camel from running away. They tie its two knees together. Therefore, a person who memorizes the Qur'an or portions of the Qur'an should be as keen in his revision of the Qur'an. Ibn Hajar extracted some beautiful benefits and instructions from the hadith. He said, we need to remember, as the Prophet said, that the Qur'an will escape. It will run away very easily and very rapidly. So we need to be careful. Number two, it encourages us to frequently review the Qur'an and recite the Qur'an in order to maintain it. Number three, he said, we need to know that lofty ranks are not easily obtained. They need effort to be exerted in order to achieve them. Al-Qadhi Iyad, may Allah have mercy on him, said, and this is something I say to my students all the time in tajweed classes, in the Quran classes, and those who are present will recollect now when I say what I'm going to say. Al-Qadhi Iyad said that the more one recites the Qur'an, the easier it becomes on his tongue to utter it. Becomes easy for you to look at the book of Allah and go through it faster. And the less you recite, the more difficult it becomes for you to read. Just like the scholar of the Qur'an, one of the most eminent scholars in the sciences of Qur'an, Muhammad ibn al-Jazari al-Shafi'i, rahmatullahi alayhi, said, وَلَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ تَرْكِهِ إِلَّا رِيَاضَةٌ رِيْنٍ بِفَكِّهِ. The protection for one to forget the Qur'an is, he literally said, exercising your jaw. meaning frequently repeating it and moving your mouth, your jaw, your tongue with it. Brothers and sisters, the Qur'an is a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jalla. It's a light that illuminates our path towards guidance. It's the strong bond. The one who holds on to it has indeed grasped on the strongest, most trustworthy handhold that has no break in it, and whoever neglects it will certainly deviate far away. The Qur'an is the source of reformation of the Muslim Ummah, politically, financially, socially, and so on. It organizes the Muslim community's affairs and life. It rectifies the affairs of individuals and governs the conduct and behavior of the believer. It is the remedy for the illnesses of the heart. And it is the softener for hard hearts. As Allah Azza wa Jalla said, Allah nazzala ahsan al-hadith kitaban mutashabiha. Allah has sent down the best statement, the best speech, a consistent book. مَثَانِيَ تَقْشَعِرُ مِنْهُ جُلُودُ الَّذِينَ يَخْشَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ. Oft repeated, the skins of those who fear the Lord shiver from it. ثُمَّ تَلِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ. Then their skins and hearts relax and soften. Why? ثُمَّ تَلِينُ جُلُودُهُمْ وَقُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. For the mention of Allah, for the Qur'an. Mathani, oft repeated. The scholar said, this means that the more it is repeated, the sweeter it becomes in the heart of the believer. And this is certainly is experienced. And I'm sure all of you have experienced this. The more you recite the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the more sweetness it has to it. It never ceases to astonish you. And it also means that the instructions, the guidance, the lessons, the admonitions in the Qur'an are also repeated, so they become deeply instilled and firm in the hearts and the minds of the believer. Allah also gave the Qur'an an amazing name. Allah says, وَكَذَٰلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا. And thus, we have revealed upon you a life-given inspiration of our command. It is the source of life for the heart. Meaning, without it, our hearts die. Without it, our hearts harden. Without it, we become like robots, not humans. So how can it be the source of our lives, the life for our hearts, and neglect it? How can it be the source of light and we abandon it? How can anyone desert it when it is so beneficial? Not only that, there's a stern warning for those who forget it. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, rahmatullahi alayhi, said, whoever forgets the Qur'an is sinful. Ibn al-Munadi, rahmatullahi alayhi, said, our Salaf continued to fear forgetting anything they memorized from the Qur'an because they thought that this, or they believed that this was a sign of decline for them in faith. Al-Imam al-Nawawi gave a stronger statement regarding forgetting the Qur'an. He said, Islam encouraged us to review and recite the Qur'an frequently, lest we forget it. Why? He said, forgetting the Qur'an is one of the major grave sins in Islam. Al-Dhahhak, rahmatullahi alayhi, said, whoever forgets anything from the Qur'an, it's due to a sin he's committed. And then he's recited, وَمَا أَصَابَكُمْ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ. And whatever adversity strikes you, it is the result of what your hands have earned. And then he said, and what greater a disaster can there be than forgetting the Qur'an? Indeed, it is a disaster. It is a calamity. And it is a form of punishment from Allah Azza wa Jal. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to protect us and to rectify our affairs and to help us abundantly review and recite the Qur'an. Allah Azza wa Jal, brothers and sisters, blessed us with the Qur'an. It's a great bounty and a great gift from Allah Azza wa Jal. It is the final and best message which was revealed upon the final and the best messenger. So why are we heedless of it? Why are we heedless of it, and why do we neglect it? Why do we deal with it as if it is something that was revealed to someone else? Why do we treat it as if we don't know the objective of it? Why do we deal with it with negligence when we know that if an individual or a Muslim community neglects and abandons the Qur'an, it's due to destruction and ruin? Why do we do so when we know that we subject ourselves to the wrath of Allah? Why do we do so when we know that if we do so, Allah Azza wa Jal will enable the devils to control us, and that we will be controlled by our whims and desires? Why? And with regards to abandoning and deserting the Qur'an, which was repeated in the khutbah, let's just clarify, what does it mean to abandon or desert the Qur'an? Deserting the Qur'an and abandoning the Qur'an can be by abandoning listening to it. Number two, abandoning reciting the Qur'an, memorizing the Qur'an, abandoning taking it as judge, governing our affairs, and abandoning it in the form of not pondering upon it and not acting upon it. Among the consequences, the evil consequences of abandoning and deserting the Qur'an, is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will complain against us to Allah Azza wa Jalla.
وقال الرسول يا ربي إن قومي اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا.
And the messenger said, O my Lord, my people have taken the Quran a thing abandoned or deserted. Do you want the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to complain against you to Allah? That's an utter loss. If we make ourselves opponents to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's a failure. The result of this is known. One makes himself an enemy of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam by deserting the Quran. Listen to Ibn Taymiyyah commenting on this verse. He said this verse was followed by another one in which Allah says,
وَكَذَٰلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًا مِّنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ.
After the Prophet complained, عليه الصلاة والسلام, Allah said,
وَكَذَٰلِكَ جَعَلْنَا,
and thus we make for every Prophet an enemy from amongst the criminals. Ibn Taymiyyah said, therefore, he who deserts and abandons the Quran sets himself as an enemy to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
We all seek a happy, prosperous life, don't we? Well, those who desert the Quran in any of the forms of abandoning it or deserting it will have the opposite happen to them. Will have a sad life filled with pain and afflictions, anxiety, sorrow. Becomes a gloomy life. Why? Well, Allah tells us why. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ.
He who abandons my dhikr. Dhikr here is the Quran. He who abandons the Quran will have a distressed, difficult life. Aren't we all escaping this type of life? Don't we run away from it? Don't we always complain from depression and some darkness in the heart which we can't explain? This could be the reason. Another consequence is humility on the Day of Judgment, which is the continuation of the verse before this point.
وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى.
And we will resurrect him on the Day of Judgment blind, as a form of humility. The scholar said, he will not see anything that's pleasing to him on that day. Do we want the Quran to invoke a curse against us? Maymun ibn Mihran said, perhaps a person will be reciting the Quran and the Quran is cursing him or her. So people asked him, how can this happen? How can someone be holding the Quran and reciting it and the Quran is cursing him? He said, he will be reading, أَلَا لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الظَّالِمِينَ. The curse of Allah is upon those who are oppressors and he oppresses others. He will be reciting, لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. The curse of Allah is upon the liars and he would lie. He would be reciting, فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Be ready for a war by Allah and His Messenger against you for dealing in riba. And he will be easily dealing in riba.
When we don't act upon the Qur'an, we subject ourselves to be cursed by the Qur'an. Brothers and sisters, it is not befitting for Qur'an to be such an important thing in our lives, and we only give it what's left over from our times. Some people don't hold the Qur'an except in Ramadan. This is when they know that there is something called Qur'an. Some people are better. They remember it on Friday. Why? What's our problem with the Qur'an? How can someone supplicate Allah saying, Allahumma ja'al al-Qur'ana rabi'a qalbi. Oh Allah, make the Qur'an the delight of my heart. How can it be the delight of my heart when I am deserting it all year long? When I don't touch it, except on Fridays. Or when I don't read it daily. And if I do read, I read 2-3 verses. Brothers, this is the source of life to my heart and yours. This is our protection from deviation. This is our prosperity. Don't we want that? Don't we strive to get that? Don't we always complain? My kids are giving me problems. My husband is harsh. My wife is disobedient. My boss is too bossy. This is happening. I'm losing a lot of money. My car is always in accidents. Of course, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا. This is the consequence. It's a natural result. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to reform our hearts, to rectify our affairs, to make our hearts attached to the Qur'an, to make us love reciting the Qur'an and memorizing the Qur'an, to find life, to find joy when we recite the Qur'an.